siswa saya ini. Pak Jaka, dikelihatkan wajahnya, nak. Dikasih background, nak.
Iya, dokter.
Pakai PC, pakai background ya, pakai PC.
Siap, dok.
Kecuali kalau ini apa namanya, kecuali kalau PC-nya lama ya, atau laptopnya lama memang sulit ya. Tapi saya harap kalau saudara pakai PC lama, jangan takut-takut minta bantuan dana ke FKH ya.
Iya, ta.
Nanti berapa saya apa saya anukan saya ganti saya tambahin nanti.
Baiknya dokter Helmi itu ya.
Udah. Oh, saya dengan mahasiswa jelek tapi dengan mahasiswi baik. Ya Feni ya. Saya ini senang sama Feni. Tadi kuliah pertama jam 8 belum mandi dia. Saya tegur.
Kok
Akhirnya
tahu?
Saya suruh raup dia.
Kok
Ternyata
tahu?
raup bermasalah. Air petnya mapet. Wah kacau. Tapi nggak apa-apa. Akhirnya tetap tetap ikut ya Feni ya.
Ini mahasiswanya Dr. Ubo juga ikut gabung ya kayaknya ya. Tapi belum ada ya. Belum
Iya,
ada
belum
mana.
ada, belum ada.
Yeah.
Iya, kesulitan kita. Teknisnya jam 8, di sana masih tidur ini. Dokter Hugo. Good afternoon, Dokter Hugo.
Masih loading, dokter.
Masih loading, oke.
Masih connecting to audio.
Iya. Kita berdoa semoga di sana jaringannya tidak biar pet ya.
Kalau connecting to audionya lama ini kelihatannya anu nih. Katanya agak sulit koneksinya. Coba aja kita.
Nanti kita tawari paketan di sini aja nanti. Ya, Din ya.
Ini dokter.
Oh, di sana pagi ya, di sana pagi ya.
Agaknya kesulitan koneksi itu. Kelihatannya Dr. Ubu
Iya,
tuh
iya, iya.
sudah bicara tapi kok belum.
Iya. Oh, pakai pakai HP dia.
Good morning, Dr. Ubu.
Dr. Hugo, are you with me, Dr. Hugo?
Halo Dr. Ugbo, good morning. Can you hear my voice?
Very clear.
Oh yeah, good. Your connection, I think it's not very good, yeah, Dr. Ugbo, I'm so sorry. I cannot clear hear your voice.
Okay. I'm very well.
Dr. Hugo, your voice is not quite clear.
Oh. Okay, let me see what I can do.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, okay.
Hello, Prof.
Yeah, Dr. Hugo, yeah,
Prof,
okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes. I hear your voice now. It's okay.
Yeah, okay.
Okay.
It's clear now. It's clear now, Dr. Ubo. Okay. Yes.
Jamaica.
Kurang 4 menit dimulai atau menunggu dulu dokter?
Okay, you can ask Dr. Hugo about that. If Dr. Hugo ready for give presentation, it's okay.
Okay. Hello, Dr. Emmanuel. Are you ready for your lecture or no? If you are ready, we can start now. Halo, Dr. Emmanuel. You are still unmute. You are still mute your microphone. Yeah. Hello. I can hear your voice.
Hello.
Okay, hello.
Okay.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, of course.
Okay.
Are you ready or no?
Yes.
Okay.
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 Okay. I will start now. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good afternoon.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi.
First of all, let us pray and wish to Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala because of His grace and mercy, we can meet together without any obstacle here with healthy condition in this case lecture about antimicrobial resistant cases in Nigeria. The Honorable Dr. Rimayanti, DVM Master of Health, as Vice Dean of Education Affairs, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Erlangga University, the Honorable Dr. Mustafa Helmi Effendi, DVM DPAPH, as Vice Dean of Research and Community Services, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Erlangga University, the Honorable Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ukwo, as guest lecturer from Department of Applied Microbiology, Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria. The Honorable Lecturer from Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Erlangga University. The Honorable Student from Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria, and all students of Veterinary Preparation Program, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Erlangga University. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Adiana Mutamsari Witaningrum and welcome to today's guest lecture. Before we come to the main session, let us start this by praying first. So the event that we will hold on this day will run well without any obstacle at all. Pray based on individual belief. Pray begins. Dan, ladies and gentlemen, on this nice occasion, let me deliver the structure of the event today as follows. The first one, opening. The second, the speech from Dr. Rimayanti. The third one, the general lecture, which will be delivered by Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ukwo. And the fourth one, the question and answer session. And the last is closing. Now we invite Dr. Rimayanti to give speech. To Dr. Rimayanti, time is yours.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I would like to welcome the Vice Dean of Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Erlangga, Dr. Mustafa Helmi Effendi, and then as well as welcome to our honorable guest lecturer today, Dr. Nabuike Ukbo, PhD from Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria. We welcome you, Dr. Emmanuel, to the virtual classroom.
Thank you, Ma.
Faculty of Veterinary.
Thank you.
Mas Elangga, Surabaya, Indonesia. Welcome our honorable lecturers and students of the Doctor of Veterinary Medicine Profession Program or Pendidikan Profesi Dokter Hewan, PPDH, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine Universitas Erlangga, who might join the guest lecture this afternoon. And also welcome, we look the students of Dr. Emmanuel Nabuike from Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria, who attend this lecture today. Welcome to our class, yeah, to the students of Dr. Emmanuel. I would like to thank participants who have joined the guest lecture today in the virtual classroom of Doctor of Veterinary Medicine Profession Program, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Universitas Erlangga. So, ladies and gentlemen, today we attend a guest lecture, a speech about antimicrobial resistance cases in Nigeria. Even though this lectures and transfer knowledge are given online, hopefully all of us can obtain a great knowledge and discussion. We hope that we can learn a lot from the lecture session. So there is a blessing in this case, pandemic situation, yeah, because make it us easier to attend the meeting online through the boundaries of space, location, and time. As we know, Dr. Emmanuel Nabuike delivered speech from Nigeria, and now in Nigeria, around 8 a.m., yeah, Dr. Emmanuel, yeah, is it right?
Yes.
Yeah, and we are in
8 a.m., 3 minutes past 8.
Yes, yeah. We are in Indonesia now, in Indonesia around 2 p.m. So there is no boundaries of space, location, and time. It's yeah, alhamdulillah, yeah. Thanks God. I would like to thank the Division of Veterinary Public Health, Faculty of Veterinary Medicine Universitas Erlangga, chaired by Dr. Dadi Raharjo, and all of the lecturers in the division for organizing this event. And of course, a special thanks to our speaker today, Dr. Emmanuel Nabuike Ogbo, for delivering such important material so that all of us can deepen our knowledge. We really appreciate that, Doctor. Finally, I hope this program will be fruitful for all of us. Thank you very much. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi
wabarakatuh.
Thank you, Ma.
The speech delivered by Dr. Rimayanti. Thanks to Dr. Rimayanti for the speech. And first of all, please allow me to take a picture all of you in this event. So please turn on all your camera. We will screenshot all slides in this screen. Okay, wait a minute. Okay, please turn on your camera. This is the for the slide one. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, and slide two. Okay, get ready. 1, 2, 3. Yeah. For slide three, please turn on your camera. Okay, and the last, get ready. Okay, 1, 2, 3. Okay, thank you. Before we get started, I would like to offer a few items so you know how to participate in today's event. You have joined the presentation by using your own phone, tablet, or computer. You will not be able to activate the feature, unmute the microphone until we allow you to do so. In your Zoom control panel, you will have chat box. for general question related this with this program and the lecture, please put your question in the chat box. You will have the opportunity to submit text question to today's lecturer by typing your question into the chat of the control panel. You may send in your question at any time during the presentation. We will collect this and address them at the end of the presentation. In this session, we have one distinguished lecturer. This lecturer is Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ukpo, PhD, from Department of Applied Microbiology, Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria. Without any further ado, let we start to this lecture. Before that, I would now like to introduce our guest lecturer. Our lecturer is Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ukpo, PhD, graduate bachelor, master and doctor degree from Ebonyi State University, Nigeria. His research area is applied microbiology. He is also actively some personal duties. And now he is attendee for postdoctoral program in Faculty of Veterinary Medicine, Airlangga University, Indonesia. He will deliver the topic for today's presentation entitled Antimicrobial Resistant Cases in Nigeria. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ukpo, PhD for Dr. Emmanuel. The time is yours. Okay, doctor, you can start your lecture now.
Good morning, my professor, and other distinguished colleagues present for this honorable guest, honorable occasion. My name is Dr. Emmanuel Ugo Nabike. I am to make a presentation on antimicrobial resistance cases in Nigeria. Biography of Nigeria. Nigeria has a multifactorial tech sector and is located in West African region of Africa. It is a country with over 200 million people in different, with different ethnic diversity and cultural value. The major causes of morbidity and mortality in Nigeria are communicable diseases. And these are generally managed using antimicrobial drugs, whose usefulness is being threatened by antimicrobial resistance. Antimicrobial resistance threatens all the countries in different ways, to various and varying extents. Antimicrobial resistance is the ability of microorganisms to withstand an antimicrobial agent of which they were once sensitive to it. Antimicrobial resistance is one of the biggest threats to global health and food security, which Nigeria is not an exception. Resistance to antimicrobial agents has become a major source of morbidity and mortality worldwide. Antimicrobial resistance currently affects human, animal, and environmental health. Antimicrobial agents can be categorized based on their mechanism of actions. One, cell wall synthesis inhibitor. Example, beta-lactam, which penicillin is one of the antimicrobial agents in that group. Another one is cell wall depolarizers. Example, daptomycin. Next one is protein synthesis inhibitor. Example of antibiotics in that category is tetracycline. Next one is nucleic acid synthesis inhibitor. Example in that group is quinolone. That is sulfurolysin. Most pathogenic microorganism has the ability to develop resistance to some of these antimicrobial agents. The summary of what I tried to put up front is displayed here. You can see the antibiotic target point and the antibiotic resistance part of the cell. Like I said before, we have cell wall, which under cell wall inhibitor, we have beta-lactam. An example again is vancomycin. You see the cell wall where they are to be attacked, and the one that is to attack the DNA synthesis or the RNA synthesis. But in the aspect of the antimicrobial resistance, you can see under the first category, the organism can actually intend to use efflux pump when the antibiotics gets into the cell. They can actually try to use efflux pump to pump out the antibiotics out of the cell. And another way it can actually cause resistance is by passing the cell wall synthesis. And another way is either by modifying the DNA of the cell, either modifying the target point of the antibiotics, in which when the antibiotics is being administered to target the particular target point, instead of it targeting it, it's going to see a different a structure that it cannot actually bind to it, thereby causing a resistance. And it can also cause resistance based on production of enzymes that can hydrolyze the antibiotics. And by so doing, they will now inactivate the activity of the antibiotics, and the organism cannot actually be inhibited. The antibiotics will now be useless before the organism. Factors contributing to antimicrobial resistance. One of the factors that can lead to antimicrobial resistance is environmental factors, drug-related factors, patient-related factors, and physician-related factors. Under environmental-related factors, overcrowding. When people intend to live in overcrowded environments, they intend to actually disseminate microorganisms that harbors resistant gene. And the second one, again, is poor sanitation. People living in a dirty environment tend to get down with the diseases and the infection caused by microorganism or pathogenic organism. And the next one is effective infectious control program. In areas where there is no effective infectious control program, the people living in that area tend to abuse antibiotics. increased national and international travel. People traveling from different areas, one country to another, one geographical area to another, can actually import one resistant organism to another geographical area. Widespread use of antibiotics in animal husbandry and agri as a growth promoter. So it has been a practice that some people actually use antibiotics to enhance the growth of their animals. And sometimes they use it as a kind of a preventive measure for the animals not to get down of disease. By so doing that, they intend to kind of embrace antimicrobial resistance or encourage antimicrobial resistance. Drug-related factors. Fake drugs. People tend to bring in fake drugs to sell to people. And as since some of the buyers of these drugs are not specialists, they don't intend to know which one is fake and the one that is not fake. Quality of the drugs. Sometimes the quality of drug can be lesser than what it's supposed to be. And these things are the factors that can actually encourage resistance in organism. Over-the-counter availability of antimicrobial. Research has shown that most of those antimicrobial agents that are mainly easily available in the counter, that people tend to abuse it because they can actually get it easily. There is no regulation on how they are being sold. And that can actually encourage somebody that is not actually a specialist can actually prescribe drug of this food and start using. And they won't even know when they are to take the proper regimen and when not to take the wrong regimen. An irrational fixing dosage combination. People tend to combine drug, but not actually knowing the actual dosage you can use to combine the drug when you want to treat a particular infection. Patient-related factor. Poverty can actually encourage antimicrobial resistance in the sense that people that are poor, they intend to go to buy drug, a lesser drug, or they can even get with the one that they can afford, instead of them buying a drug that can actually make them to complete a regimen that can inhibit or can clear the infection that they are actually having. But they will not intend to buy a lesser one because of what their money can afford. Poor concept or lack of sanitation. When people don't keep neat, or when patients don't keep neat, they can actually encourage dissemination of pathogenic microorganisms. Self-medication. Many people tend to practice self-medication. Instead of them going to a physician or a specialist who can actually give them the normal regimen, they intend to go to self-medication because maybe they have a little knowledge of how drug can be used. They will now try a kind of saving their money instead of going to hospital to pay money to get the medical checkup or any other thing. They will tend to treat themselves on their own. Poor adherence of dosage regimen. Sometimes patients can go to hospital. Physicians can give them the normal dosage to use, the level the infection, get rid of. But when they get to their different destinations, they intend to use the drug maybe when they heard that this sickness that is giving me problems is actually subsides. They will preach the dosages. And this will tend to encourage antimicrobial resistance. and lack of education. When people are not widely educated, the importance of drug abuse and the outcome that it can actually cost a lot of money from government, they intend to abuse drug. Physicians and prescribers related the factor. Inadequate dosing can actually encourage antimicrobial resistance. And inappropriate usage of a valuable drug. Because sometimes some of the doctors don't actually use the appropriate drug that is supposed to be used to administer for a particular infection. They intend to use the one that is available in their hospital. And this can actually encourage antimicrobial resistance. Next one is overusage of antimicrobial. Some antimicrobial agent has been overused for a very long period of time in treating a particular infection. And well, this can actually, because you use it frequently to treat a particular microorganism without a kind of combination or changing of antimicrobial agent, the organism can actually get acquainted with that particular antimicrobial agent. Thereby, when it is being administered on that person, it intends, the organism tends to be resistant to the antimicrobial agent. Lack of training and current knowledge. Some of the physicians are not actually ready to embrace the current knowledge in different current knowledge in the way of administering drug and drug combination. Mode of spread of antimicrobial resistance. As you can see from this picture right here, resistance can actually be carried. Animals can carry harmful bacteria in their intestine. And they can actually go on disseminating it into the environment. And it can be sprayed into our food, crops, and other things. And people can get sick with resistant infection by either eating food contaminated by this organism. And the impact of this is either the patient gets sick, and sometimes it can actually lead to the death of the patient. Antibiotics resistance can actually be grouped into two different ways. It can be natural and it can be acquired. Under acquired, it can be genetic methods. It can come in non-genetic form and non-genetic form. Under genetic form, organisms can actually acquire resistant gene through mutation. Either they mutate one of their amino acid sequence, which can actually, once they change the code of one of their amino acid sequence, it can actually make them to form resistance to the drug that they were susceptible to before. And also, they can actually acquire plasmid that carries a resistant gene. It can be transferred from one organism to the other. And by so doing that, they can actually encourage resistance. And next one is by production of an enzyme that is under biochemical mechanism. Organism can actually produce enzymes that can hydrolyze the antibiotics when they are being taking. They will produce the enzymes that will now attack the antibodies by hydrolysis method. They can actually modify the target site or use alternative pathway, or they can even use a oral sensor. Whereby, where there is insufficient food, they can actually look for a mode of surviving by acquiring an extra strong gene that can actually help them to survive a harsher environment. Mechanism of antimicrobial resistance. Bacteria uses the several mechanisms to develop antimicrobial resistance. Like I said before, it can be natural, either by limiting uptake of the drug or modification of drug target site or inactivation of a drug or active effluent pump of the drug from out of their cells. This diagram explains the mechanism of antimicrobial resistance. Like I said, modification of the cell wall proteins. You can see where this organism has actually modified the cell wall. And when you administer the antibiotics, because the cell wall is no longer what they used to know, they can actually use it to bypass the attack of the antibiotics. Modification of drug target site. They can actually modify where the drug is supposed to target, like you can see from this particular structure here, the organism has modified the binding site of the drug. Thereby, it cannot bind again. When the antibiotic comes, it cannot actually locate the socket of binding site. Pumping out, that is effluent drug pump. This particular drug, the antibiotics here is meant to target this particular organism. But because of this capacity to pull off the drug out of this cell, when it is being administered, it goes inside the cell, it pumps it out of the cell. And that is what you are seeing that is happening here. And another one is this inactivation of the antibiotics. Adding an effluent group on the antibiotics, which will reduce its ability to bind to the bacterial ribosomes. Antimicrobial resistant cases in Nigeria. That is from a Nigerian National Action Plan for Antimicrobial Resistance 2017 to 2022 showed non-typhoidal salmonella had a flowing resistance. Nalazidic acid, the resistance is ranging from 0 to 100% currently in Nigeria. Chlorofenicol, resistance being experienced is ranging from 36% to 100%. Cotrimazole, 0 to 100%. Ampicillin, 50 to 100%. Amoxicillin, 0 to 90%. Ciprofloxacin, 0 to 30%. Ofloxacin, 0 to 20%. Tetracycline, 0 to 100%. Penicillin, 0 to 100%. This data is from National Action Plan for Antimicrobial Resistance in Nigeria. Systematic review on bacterial isolates causing pneumonia, meningitis, urinary tract infection, and blood infection and diarrhea. This systematic review in Nigeria showed that some selected antibiotics was used to test E. coli and Klebsiella species isolated from these areas I mentioned. And after the whole review or the study, they found out that ampicillin, when it is being administered to E. coli, Escherichia coli, They found out that the resistance index is ranging from 63.4 to 93.8. And when it is administered to Klebsiella's machine, the resistance index is ranging from 80.9 to 100%. Amoxicillin clavulanic acid, when it was used on E. coli, it was discovered that the resistance experience is 22.3 to 79.5. And for Klebsiella pneumonia or Klebsiella species, it is 19.0 to 89.4. Cefotaxone, 9.9 to 28.4 for E. coli, and 15.1 to 48.7 for Klebsiella. Ceftazidime, 0.0 to 79.4 for E. coli, and 25.4 to 64 for Klebsiella. Gentamicin, 4.2 to 50.5 for E. coli, and 1.6 to 56.1 for Klebsiella. Ciprofloxacin, 10.6 to 40.8 for E. coli, and 10.3 to 36.8 for Klebsiella. Trimetoprim, sulfamethoxazole, 52.5 to 90.6 for E. coli, and 22.6 to 94.8 for Klebsiella species. Average antimicrobial resistance rate when Haemophilus influenza was used to test these antibiotics, penicillin G had a resistance index of 0 to 66.7. Chlorpheniclone, 0 to 23.5. Ceftriaxone, 4.5%. When it is also tested on another organism, Streptococcus pneumonia, it was penicillin had 0 to 45.2%, and chlorpheniclone 0 to 10.3%. Ceftriaxone 1.7%. Drug like ciprofloxacin, and augmentin no longer work for patients infected by organisms that produces extended spectrum beta lactamase. Powerful substances such as piperacillin, taxobatam, and meropenem are drugs of choice. In Nigeria today, vancomycin still remains the drug of choice for methicillin-resistant staph aureus. Under National Agricultural Sample Survey, estimated Nigeria livestock as one of the largest in Africa, with the average of livestock as follows. 1.45 million chicken, 5 million cows, 5 million goats, 3 million sheep, and 1 million pig, and 28,000 camel. Many livestock producers use antibiotics to boost the growth in animals and to treat or prevent diseases from attacking without proper diagnosis or professional advisors in Nigeria. Many farmers mix 3 to 5 antibiotics to the animal drinking water, and the practice is widespread. Study confirmed that out of 9 antibiotics used for treatment of animals and livestock, birds and other livestock, 8 antibiotics were resistant. That is to show the level of abuse this antibiotics has been projected to. One of the antibiotics that we are resistant are augmentin, oxytetracycline, streptomycin, enrofloxacin, gentamicin, and others. The only antibiotic standing is colistin, which should not be used on animal. This data is coming from Federal Minister of Agriculture, from Department of Veterinary and Disease Control. Antimicrobial resistant cases in Nigeria. Study on resistant level of staph aureus isolated from animal carcass showed that benzin penicillin had 100% resistance. Erythromycin 0 to 58.3%. Tetracycline 16.7 to 100%. And trimethoprim sulfamethoxazole is 0 to 100%. National Nigerian Disease Control Center, NCDC, in 2017 stated that the rising in antimicrobial resistant cases in Nigeria is as a result of the following. 1, the lack of national antimicrobial resistant laboratory surveillance system. No dedicated fund to control antimicrobial resistance. Limited collaboration across the health sectors, animal health and environmental health sector. Lack of antimicrobial stewardship in both private and public sectors. And poor public awareness on antimicrobial resistance. Prevention and control of antimicrobial resistance in Nigeria. NCDC has established 9 surveillance sites in various geopolitical zones to collect data on antimicrobial resistance. Improvement of awareness and understanding of antimicrobial resistance in Nigeria is very paramount and very, very important. Doctors and health workers should prescribe and dispense antibiotics when they are needed, according to the current guidelines. Report antimicrobial resistant infection to surveillance team. Animal farmers can only give antibiotics to animals under veterinary supervision. Use of antibiotics for growth promotion or to prevent diseases in healthy animal should be discouraged. Regular vaccination of animals to reduce the need for antibiotics is very, very paramount. So this is how far antimicrobial resistant case has been in Nigeria. It has not been easy, though government has actually neglected that aspect of health. But currently, they are doing things to see how they can actually reduce the impact of antimicrobial resistance on the health sector and public fund, because government is actually spending a lot of money, or people are actually spending a lot of money unknowingly on antimicrobial resistant organisms. That is what one can actually avoid by adhering to the proper instructions. And this, with the work that antimicrobial committee ethic are doing in Nigeria, I believe in time to come, they can actually reduce the index of the resistance and the abuse of antibiotics in Nigeria. Thanks for listening.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Emmanuel, for your presentation. Ladies and thank you for your interesting lecture. So, ladies and gentlemen, we are now going to take a question and answer session. As a reminder, you can still submit your question through the chat box on your attendee control panel. So, any question may be directly delivered to Dr. Emmanuel.
Okay, I have one question.
Okay, Dr. Helmy.
Okay, Dr. Emmanuel.
Directly.
Could you give me data about extended spectrum beta lactamase from poultry production? Is there any data from there?
Prof.
Yes.
Can you repeat, please?
Is there any data about extended beta lactamase from poultry production?
Well, I have not actually seen a data, but there are a lot of research in Nigeria that can actually show us the extent or that we can actually gather data from extended spectrum beta lactam antibiotics.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay, okay, thanks. That means there is no data about that, yeah?
There is no data from there yet, but we can actually get data from individual researchers that is online. That can actually help us, because there have not been actually any national survey on that area.
How about data about methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus from pets animal? Any data about that? Methicillin?
No, I couldn't get.
Yes?
Methicillin. I couldn't get data from that, but I know.
Yes, yes, yes. Okay.
I couldn't get data from that. But I know there are some data online on it. If you need
I can
actually arrange data online on the work that has been conducted on that area. And I'll get the data for you, Prof.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Nabeke. Thank you, Dr. Adiana.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Okay, maybe later you can presentation in the next guest lecture. about MRSA or ESBL in Nigeria. Okay. Maybe any question for audience? You can directly to deliver to Dr. Naibuki. Okay. Any question? Okay. Mr. Goodwill, can you directly deliver your question? Yeah. Sorry, your voice still unmute. Still mute.
Unmute, please. Yeah, Dr. Unmute. Goodwill. Unmute, unmute, unmute. Yeah, okay.
All right. Okay. My question to Dr. Emmanuel is, how dangerous is this extended spectrum beta-lactamase in Nigeria? Just like Prof was asking for in data, I'm also interested to know how dangerous, what is the frequency of extended spectrum beta-lactamase in Nigeria? That is my question.
Thank you.
Okay, thank
for
you.
Your question. Actually, extended spectrum, like it sounds, this is a antibiotic that's supposed to take care of both infection caused by gram negative and the gram positive organism. That's why they are called extended spectrum. But in Nigeria today, a lot of research has been done on extended spectrum beta-lactam drug. And from those research, there have been a great resistance, especially E. coli, that comes from urinary tract infection. They have actually presented a great resistance to some of these antibiotics that belong to this class of antibiotics. So it is not what people can actually be abusing, because it's supposed to be one of the drug of remedies for any kind of infection. But due to the level of abuse, like if you look at some of those antibiotics that come from extended spectrum, central spectrum class, the only ones that are still showing a great extent are those ones that are not in tablet form, those ones that are injection form. But those ones that are in tablet form, people abuse it. Thanks.
Okay. Adriana, I have one
question. Okay.
Okay, any question for Dr.
Okay, I have one Bill? Question. It's okay, Dr. Okay. Emmanuel?
Okay, it's okay.
Okay. Dr. Emmanuel, any evidence extended spectrum beta-lactamase from poultry production spreading to human health in Nigeria? Any evidence extended spectrum beta-lactamase from poultry production spread to human health?
I can't hear you very well.
Maybe repeat again, Dr. Helmi.
I just one question. Any evidence extended spectrum beta-lactamase spreading from poultry production to human health in Nigeria? Any evidence?
Sorry, your voice still mute, Dr. Emmanuel.
Your voice, Dr. Emmanuel, your voice still mute. Please unmute your voice, please. Your voice still mute.
Your speaker still unmute. Still mute.
Okay.
Prof, state Zaya question very well because of network. Network is not at its bridging. Please, can you repeat Zaya question, please? Let me just get it once and for all.
Oh, any evidence, any data spreading extended spectrum beta lactamase from poultry production to human health in Nigeria. You got the point?
Yes, Prof. I got your question right now. Thanks. There are some research.
Yes.
There are some research that prove that there are data that express extended spectrum beta lactamase to human. Because there are some research people have done from isolate from a livestock that actually exhibited extended spectrum.
Yes, yes.
Do you get my... So though me, I have done the research, but it's not on livestock. It is from human samples. And I actually isolated extended organism producing extended spectrum beta lactamase. I isolated E. coli and Klebsiella from human samples. Mm-hmm. So, but there are some data from research that has been published that is showing the evidences of isolate from life from poultry and the poultry workers.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
So I can get the data.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Emmanuel.
Thank you.
I glad for your information, this one. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, you're welcome, bro.
Okay, thank you very much
for the question. Okay, we must help another guest lecture about MRSA or ASBL. Yeah, for the clear situation MRSA and ASBL in Nigeria. So, any question for participants?
So I think, Dr. Diana, I want to tell Dr. Emmanuel, next week I send three articles related with the antimicrobial resistance to you to make comment, Dr. Emmanuel. I will send a manuscript article to you privately to make comment in this article.
It's okay, Prof. You
yes.
Send it.
Okay. Okay, thank you. So we can make a collaboration between Erlangga University and Nigeria University. Okay, good. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Helmi. And then Dr. Godswill, you will ask.
I'm during the meeting, they are speaking. They're not speaking English.
Pardon? Okay.
No, there is some error. And
okay.
So, Dr. Godswill, you can ask your question directly. Okay.
Right. Okay. I was actually going to make a direct contribution to what Prof said initially. Am I audible enough?
I'm not quite hear your voice, Dr. Godswill.
Sorry, your voice disappeared, doctor.
Dr. Godswill, I'm not hear your voice.
Can you hear me now?
Okay. It's good. Yeah, okay.
Sorry for that. So the question I initially asked, I want to thank Dr. Emmanuel he actually answered what I wanted, actually. How difficult ESPA has been in Nigeria. It has been very menacing in the country. So Dr. Emmanuel was actually linking poultry ESBO that have been acquired through poultry to how they affect our lives here in Nigeria. And I tell you, that data is actually correct because the way people go about making use of antibiotics and enhancing poultry feeds to enable them to produce faster than it should be has actually been a problem in Nigeria. You see, a chick that should actually last 4 or 5 months to grow will take sometimes 2 months or a month to grow in Nigeria. And you wonder what happens there. It is this drug enhancement that they add to the feed and water of these chicks that makes them grow fast. So that actually poses a risk to we, the consumers. Because when we consume these, eating together these antibiotics into our system, they form drug resistance. These microorganisms become resistant to these drugs. And the worst part of it is that they use conventional antibiotics. Antibiotics that we ourselves make use of. These are what they use in enhancing poultry feeds. So that makes EXPL inescapable for everyone down here in our country. So I actually am very happy to be at this conference to hear this because it is very menacing in Nigeria. It is everywhere in this country and people are not even doing anything. The government is not doing anything to curb ASPL. So that is just a little contribution I have there. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Godswill, for your statement. And maybe any question for participant? Any question?
Okay.
How about Dr. Helmy?
I think it's enough. I would like to say thank you very much for Dr. Emmanuel for your interesting presentation this morning.
Thank you, Prof.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, Doctor, for the question and answer session. So this is the end of question and answer session. Thank you to audience that had participate actively. And from today's lecture, let me try to recapitulate the message from our distinguished lecturer is antimicrobial resistance is one of the most serious global public health. So we must use antibiotic or antimicrobial only with prescription and by certified with health professional and always take full prescription even if you feel better and never use leftover antibiotic and never share antibiotic with others. So thank you, Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ugo, PhD, and everyone for attending today's guest lecture. Before I end this session, on behalf of Faculty Veterinary Medicine Erlangga University Indonesia, I would like to hand over the certificate of appreciation to our distinguished lecturer virtually. The certificate will be hand over to Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Ugo, PhD, from Department of Applied Microbiology, Ebonyi State University, Abakaliki, Nigeria. Thank you, Doctor, for your interesting lecture. So maybe administration can share the Okay, this is the. Okay, we will wait. Okay, this is a certificate to Dr. Emmanuel. This is our appreciate for your lecturer. And finally, we get to the last session in this event that is closing. let's close this event by saying Alhamdulillah. As
Alhamdulillahirabbil alamin.
Amin. As the master of ceremony, I would like to thank Dr. Emmanuel Nabuiki Upo as the lecturer, Dr. Imayanti, Dr. Mustafa Helmi Effendi, the committee, and the audience for joining us today entirely. May what we had conducted will be useful for us. One more time, I say see you in the next event. Have a great rest of your day. If in guiding this event, I made mistake or often someone here, please forgive me. Good afternoon and wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Okay, thank you, Dr. Emmanuel. See you soon in the other session. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I just speaking with two people. Thank you so much. I appreciate.
Okay.
Thank you.
You are welcome. Okay.
Okay.
See you then.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
See you. Okay, thank you, Doctor. Oke, terima kasih Dr. Dian, Dr. Dandi, Dr. Prima, kalau masih ada.
Terima kasih. Enggak ada. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah. Ya, Alhamdulillah. Sudah ya, bisa lift ya.